Good morning, July 15th, 2012. We continue to press on with some fundamental truths. We cannot have the idea of changing what we are, and then within the context of that idea, experience true unity, our oneness. It's not possible. Because that would require transformation of the effects of that idea becoming something different than what they were intended to be. That is not possible. And yet, that is exactly what the vast majority of all spiritual teachings on this planet are aimed at. Unity consciousness, oneness, coming together, collective consciousness, all this. It's not possible. That itself is simply, that is the obstacle to realization. That's when we avoid the spiritual path. It's the ego that sponsors that. Even though it sounds great, right? How can you be against unity and oneness and all of that? Remember, the unity and oneness we're talking about is unity and oneness with reality, with I'm creating. It is not unity and oneness with among human beings. That is not the goal. That's the ego's goal. And yet, if you live in this world, 99.9999% of everything, every spiritual teaching you get is going to be in reinforcing the ego's goal. So it's extremely difficult here. Simply, you think if the idea dawns upon you, wait a minute, this isn't right. There's no reinforcement for that. You feel like you're all alone, like an orphan. Truth is an orphan in this world, really. And there's some teachers that play both sides of it. They kind of agree with the unity and all that, and then they say, well, but most of that really just serves the dream state, which is more than most of it, all of it, really. So these videos continuously point out this truth, and it's very tough to get at simply because there's so little reinforcement here. It's not tough to get at if you look at it, but it is the lack of reinforcement makes one feel that it's simply no support. So how can you continue on in this way? And yet we must do it. We must do it. Otherwise, the path of suffering continues. The path of disillusionment, disappointment, frustration, sickness, dying, death continues. We change the frame around the picture. Beautify the frame, but the picture remains the same. So literally everything we're doing in existence to bring about unity and all that is simply working on the frame around the picture. The picture remains the same. The picture is unchangeable. But we can continuously reframe it, which is what most people are used to thinking of as spiritual teachings. It's just the world is absolutely full of it. It didn't used to be that way, really. Spiritual teaching used to be much more on track. We're way off track right now. Way off track. We're trying to build the kingdom of heaven here on earth, which is the ego's idea. And I've gone over and over and over and over this in other videos, so how does one sustain a genuine spiritual path in this world with no reinforcement? It's very difficult, to say the least. because what one finds is that you start to see, wait a minute, these teachers that the world, you know, looks up to, they're teaching the ego's path. And you say, what in the world's going on here? And you see more and more and more and more and more, and you think, wow, that can't possibly be right, is it? I mean, no, I mean, they say they have these divine experiences of oneness and all this stuff, and they're now helping, you know, bring the planet together and develop collective systems of cooperation and unity and, you know, building a new consciousness and all this stuff. You know, it sounds so wonderful. And so you then begin to doubt, you know, what you saw in the light, your highest realization, even to doubt it. And you think that whatever you realized is supposed to be utilized to go along with the goals of existence. And it's devastating, very devastatingly difficult. So at least we can acknowledge how devastatingly difficult it is here. It doesn't do any purpose to say it's easy here. Truth is not that difficult. Seeing it is not so difficult. The difficulty is that it's unsupported here on this planet. That's the difficulty. You'd be, you know, spitting into the wind, trying to say anything because it's simply unsupported. To a very large extent, and becoming more and more so with high technology and the social media and all of that, is becoming more and more unsupported because a false hope is growing so strong in this world that, hey, you know, everybody's connected. We're all connected. But who's this we that is all connected? Human beings? We're not human beings. Bodies? We're not bodies. Species? We're not part of a species. That talk is one day we'll look at that talk as hilarious. A very funny joke. We're not human beings. We're not part of any species. We're not people. We're not part of a world. There's no worlds in reality. We've so forgotten reality that we don't even question the dream. There are no people in reality. There are no bodies in reality. There are no worlds in reality. There's not even a universe in reality. Jesus said, do not be intimidated by enormity. Okay, the universe is enormity. It seems to be very intimidating. But really, you can brush it off as nothing. But we have we've been in a state of forgetfulness for so long, we really don't remember what reality is like. We really haven't a clue. And so, of course, we think this hypothetical scenario of the universe and existence, we think this is reality. So we think there are planets and stars and universe and species and bodies and forms, and we think this is life. It's a dream. It's a hypothetical scenario that sole purpose is to bring about forgetfulness of what we are, to maintain this deep forgetfulness. So we don't even remember reality. So we continue to work within the context of this hypothetical scenario, eventually trying to become prime creator. That's what triggered this entire situation, is spirit had a desire to reverse the direction of creation and have effects be the prime creator and causes be the effect. And in order to do this, spirit had to dream a hypothetical scenario that would enable it to forget what reality, what is the truth. So it can imagine the truth could be different. So here we are, we think that we're people, We're members of a human species. We're bodies. We're body minds. This world is our home. The universe is reality. God created the universe. All this stuff. We believe it simply because we've forgotten reality. We're too afraid to disbelieve it. So we continue on with these ridiculous ideals of unifying humans, creating a collective consciousness of oneness and all this stuff among humans within this hypothetical scenario of forgetting what we are. That is not the path of salvation at all. No real teacher teaches this. We are supposed, salvation is to choose to experience the real world, another world where there's no problems, where there's no dying, where there's no death, where there's no impermanence, where there's no loss of any kind, of the light of that world into our awareness. And then from there, we remember reality. Our goal is not to transform existence, but to remember reality. And reality is not a bunch of people in unity consciousness at all. We're spirit. That's meaningless to us, what we're saying that. We cannot, in the condition we're in right now, we cannot remember what we are. We cannot. It's impossible. Doesn't matter how many, people you tweet this morning and how much collective communication is going on. It's useless, futile. When we say we're spirit, that doesn't have any meaning to us really at all. We at least something reality. There's no thing as energy. Energy is the hypothetical scenario that we dreamed up, that we're imagining. Spirit, we're imagining a hypothetical scenario. Energy, a dance of energy, is that hypothetical scenario. God did not create energy. Reality is what we call essence, isness, being. Of energy. There is no dance of energy involved. There's no form in reality as we understand form at all. Energy-based forms or such. There's essence, and there's being, and there's isness, and there's direct experiencing. None of this is present in the hypothetical scenario that we are imagining. Which is why we really need an intermediate step that still seems to have some continuity with our hypothetical scenario. The real world is that intermediate step, in that it still uses a world and forms and seemingly energy. So there's some continuity there. Literally, behind our dreams, obscured by our dreams, is this the living light of the world, which is that which arises from our desire not to reverse the direction of creation, not to flip-flop cause and effect, not to try and be prime creator. Our desire to let reality be what it is, that gives rise to this living light that presents itself as in familiar format, like a world. And maybe even beings in a world. And by experiencing that, then this experiencing gets easily translated back into reality, back into essence and being. That is the path of salvation. Working to connect in this world is the ego's plan to give you false hope so you don't turn towards God's plan of salvation. Really. You see, God does have a plan of salvation for us, and it's right there for us. Immediately present and available always. So the ego has to present a counter plan. Otherwise, we catch wind of God's plan. happens and accept it. So the ego has us frantically pursuing its plan, the ego's plan of transformation, so that we don't pay attention to God's plan that is present all the time. And so we can continue on with our hope that we can be prime creators, that we can reverse cause and effect. We're an effect of the prime creator. Spirit's an effect. If we want to be prime creator, we'd have to reverse cause and effect and say that effects cause, or that effects are causeless. That's another way. Effects are causeless. Trying to build a separate reality of causelessness, just effects without any cause. And so within this separate reality, we're trying to create, of course we're trying, the ego has us working on unity consciousness and oneness and consciousness and love and all these things. The ego's frantically trying to get everybody to work on this so that we can continue to try and become prime creator. That's the purpose of this existence. That's the purpose from which existence arose, as the means. And the purpose always serves the cause. Always. It's one purpose. In cause and effect, there's one purpose. So the existence will always serve the purpose that gave rise to it, the cause, which is to be in deep forgetting what we are and attempt to create a separate reality and offer false hope that of transformation to get rid of this constant loss. You know, it has to keep perpetuating itself. It has to offer false hope constantly that things are going to get better. If you look at history, all these religious, spiritual movements of all different types and kinds, etc. You know, everyone had hope. This is it. Not a single one of them has ever panned out. As you look at that, I mean, like Theosophy, they had Krishnamurti was the head of the Order of the Star, and he was the world savior that in Theosophy was supposed to be able to bring the whole world together and organize it properly and bring unity and oneness and all this stuff. And Krishnamurti was supposed to be the one who was going to guide fruition. And Krishnamurti, being aware of truth, dissolved the Order of the Star and said, forget it. This isn't it. This is the ego. This is the play of the ego. He said, there's no path like that to reality. So that's one instance where, you know, it didn't work. Of course, it can't work. But there was someone who at least said, hey, this doesn't work, and spoke of an alternative to some extent. But none of those movements in history have ever worked, right? And they never will. They never will. They just give us kind of a sort of this vague feeling that we're doing good, that we're somehow good. Like we're meeting other people and smiling and talking and sharing ideas and stuff. How can we, you know, develop oneness? How can we function collectively? How can we all be on the same page, etc., etc.? Eventually, actually, these types of movements end up into totalitarianism and extreme coercion. So there are phases of the ego's plan that seem full of optimism and hope. What we don't see is the flip side to that. The flip side to that is that it eventually ends up in tyranny. All these ideals that we have, because the people who are engaged in this, it doesn't work, and they start to feel like it's not working because everybody's not buying into it. And even if everyone's buying into it, it still doesn't work. And then they feel that people aren't buying into it enough. and the tyranny escalates. The tyranny really escalates into severe coercion. And so you have spiritual movements in this world resulting in incredible wars and battles. And of course, we can look in history and see that. The various religions and how they've, you know, engaged in massive warfare. But it's not just the major religions, it's all the minor ones too. It's all the spiritual teachings of the world, most of them. Not all. There have been some actually underground, some true teachings. But it's the idealism of the ego's plan of salvation that grips everyone here that eventually morphs into incredible repression, tyranny, confrontation, conflict, loss, severe loss, horrible stuff, which is something that Krishnamurti pointed out, that you're just setting the seeds of a new tyranny. Let me see what can I do with this effect so it's not so jittery. all effects are very jittery, you know. So, what can I do? I always like to give some time here to catch your breath, you know. It doesn't have to be this non-stop monologue. Does not have to be that. Why is it still follow my face? Okay, I'll take that off of there. There you go. So I keep on chirping away like a bird on this. These basics, these are basics. The conflicts we see in the world, the roots of those conflicts are in idealism, spiritual idealism. And until we see that, we will just continue to undergo unbelievable suffering, heartbreak. And it's extremely important when you do come across a teaching that is actually telling you the truth, to listen to it and let it sink in and realize you're not alone. Truth is still true, even though it's rarely expressed here. And it can be seen. These things can be seen. It's very important. Because when you go out in the world, listen, you're going to hear pretty much a monolithic perspective. You know, we need to build the kingdom of heaven here in this world. Not true. Egoic teachings get into everything here. Just about everything. They creep into it because we're in such a deep forgetfulness of reality. We don't have anything to go on, you know, that's the problem. So it's so easy to believe the ego's teachings about salvation. So easy, because again, we don't have any remembrance of reality, so we just take this existence as reality, as a given. And then as soon as we do that, we're completely vulnerable to the ego's teachings, to delusional teachings, to teachings of transformation. Completely vulnerable to it. So literally it takes those who have remembered reality, who have been awakened to reality, it takes them somehow either coming into the world, or it takes those here in the world having a glimpse of reality to give out true teachings here in the world. It's impossible if you haven't had at least a glimpse of reality, or you're not listening to someone who has, who is aware of what reality really is, It's impossible to develop an immunity to the ego's teachings. You'll just go around in circles, spin your wheels. Just spin your wheels. Now, it is in existence, it is possible to have all sorts of different states of consciousness. You can even have something you call unity consciousness, etc. Okay, but it's not permanent. It's not real. It's just a state of consciousness. It's just a part of the dream. It's temporary. You can have all sorts of temporary conditions, but nothing's permanent. So you can experience what you think is unity consciousness, but it won't last. It's not permanent. And you will, it will automatically direct you towards trying to transform the world, which will eventually, you know, you get pulled down into all sorts of frustrations and conflicts, and eventually that effort itself will end up being the seeds of tyranny. What salvation really is experiencing a world that has no problems. The real teachers, you ask them, like Ananda Maima, you asked her, how do you see the world? You know, what about all these problems? She goes, what problems? I don't see any problems. See, well, people ask her, well, why aren't you trying to fix the problems in the world? She says, I don't see any problems. Everything's perfect. That, you know, that's coming from a standpoint of truth. What she's saying is you need to see the problem free, the vision of problem freeness, a vision within which there are no problems, a vision in which there can never be any problems arising, a vision in which our identity is not threatened, a vision in which our identity is flawless and perfect, eternal, not invulnerable. I mean, bodies are vulnerable. I don't care what anyone says. You know, you can't, if you believe your identity rests on a body, there's no way you can remember truth, reality at all. It's impossible. So real teachers aren't out there trying to unify the world, trying to make things better, trying to bring about transformations. No, they're just telling you, have the vision of the problem-free world, where you see an alternative to the, it's an alternative to the this world. They're not taking this world away from you. Okay, true teaching doesn't say we need to transform this world. No, it says choose an alternative world. Don't do anything this world. Let it be what it is. Don't try to take it away from anybody. Because just think for a moment, those who are talking about transforming this world into oneness. What about all the people who don't want that? You literally would be snatching it away from them and bringing about a world that they don't like at all. Most people in this world love the rough and tumble combativeness of this world, the loss of it, the struggle for survival, you know, the death and the sickness and impermanence. You know, they're feasting on it, the feeling of separation, all that. So the idea that spiritual teachers are here to transform the world. What about the vast majority of those attitudes here in the world who can't stand that? You're going to take it away from them, deprive them of that. Oh, no, God doesn't do that. That's not God's plan. God's plan is to say, here's an alternative world. If you want to remember what you are, here's an alternative world. And if you want to remain in forgetfulness of what you are, then you can remain with existence and the worlds of existence. I mean, existence, there are many worlds in existence. The fact that this planet Earth is going to be melted down by the heat of the sun, that doesn't mean that there aren't many, 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 many other worlds full of loss and struggle and impermanence and physical bodies, except humanoid experiencing, etc. Many, 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 many. And consciousness, the dream, hypothetical scenario, the play of consciousness will continue on in those worlds for those who want to do that. But it's not God that's melting the world down. It's not God who's causing loss at all. That's the hypothetical scenario, the dream scenario of existence has to do that to maintain the belief in loss, to maintain the forgetfulness of what we are, to maintain that state of forgetfulness of what we are. There's a constant drastic change. Sometimes change is super drastic. It also has to short-circuit awareness, awakening. It has to try and... We have all this, you know, push for oneness in this world now, right? So much. I mean, you could pull out maybe a million spiritual teachers on this planet who have their, you know, their faces on brochures and seminars, etc., who are teaching this oneness, collective oneness, etc., etc. And so the world, we think we're waking up, you know, these television hosts are talking about, etc. The ego doesn't want anyone to realize that this is all bogus and false. It doesn't want us to see that this doesn't work. So what's it going to do? It's going to destroy this planet, melt it down, so it can then blame the failure on the sun going turning into a red giant and the cosmic dynamics. It's going to say, well, we didn't get an opportunity to see this through to its end, so you need to then recapitulate, reconstruct this effort on another planet and go through the whole same thing all over again. And people will just say, wow, yeah. See, what a scam, isn't it, the ego, and what we do to ourselves in this dream. We're never given the opportunity to look carefully and see if these things really work. Are they really true? Ego will throw up either some big conflict or some big destruction or something and then say, guess what? You got the opportunity to start afresh anew and this time do even better. And, you know, we buy into that and off we go to another situation. Instead of choosing to be aware of the real world, the alternative world, problem-free world, that is shining there for us. It's there for us right now, but will not impinge upon our awareness unless the conditions of invitation are present. So we might think, gee, there's no alternative world because we're not seeing it. Again, that's a living light. That's a light that is intelligent, perfectly intelligent, aware. I've experienced it on several occasions, this light. And the light itself is alive. It's not the reflected light of the sun. It's not this light that's coming from the sun. This is dream light. We have imagined energy. Energy is something we're imagining. But it's not intelligent. It's not alive. We think it is because actually we are the ones who are making it, dreaming all this. So of course it seems intelligent because we're intelligent. But the light itself in the sun of the universe is not intelligent at all. There's no intelligence in the universe other than our own intelligence that is dreaming it all up. But the living light is the intelligence of reality, of God, and of all of reality. It's not some separate intelligence. You know, we have unlimited creativity, so we can use our creativity to imagine a separate reality, imagine this hypothetical scenario. And the imagining is going to be, you know, incredibly gifted and intelligent and ingenious, etc. But but it's all symbolic. So the in other words, the intelligence is not coming from what we're symbolizing, from the symbols, from energy. That is merely a symbolic dance, imaginary dance and play. It's like a puppet. The intelligence is not coming from the puppet. You can have the puppet move intelligently and say all sorts of intelligent things, but the intelligence is not coming from the puppet. But we in the dream believe that it is coming from there. But in the living light, we are aware that the light itself is intelligent. There's no disconnect between where the intelligence is coming from. All right, it's different. We are immediately aware that the light itself is alive and is intelligent. There's no process and there's no separation. It's a direct, immediate awareness of that. And I've experienced that living light. And the first thing I said was, wow, The light is alive. The light itself is alive. Whereas here, we don't think of light that we're seeing it as life itself. You see, because it's not. It's a symbol for life that we are orchestrating. And it seems to bring about life by giving energy to plants. This is all, existence is just all an energy system, a process system. It gives an illusion of life. It's an illusion of life. There's no real life to it. It's a symbol, an illusion, a mirage of life. But the living light, immediately you say, oh my gosh, this light is alive. The light itself is alive. It doesn't need to produce something living to say there's the life is there in this body. In other words, it doesn't need to produce bodies. The light itself is alive. It is the life. It is life. And everything, every way that it expresses is that same life. It's so different than what we presume here with the light of the stars. Stars, we're seeing, you know, stellar light, light from stars, which is just a bunch of gas, superheated gas and plasma. And we think that's life. And then all the reactions to this, you know, energy, we think that's life. No. So this living light that itself is life. It's eternal, eternal life. That living light is supremely wise and aware and intelligent. And it knows the conditions of our awareness. If the invitation is there or not. And if the invitation isn't there or not, it is not going to impinge on our awareness. It's not going to force its way into our awareness. Now, we can force ourselves to have a glimpse of it, as it were. But we'll rebound from that. We will not abide in it. It's not the same thing as this light coming to us and abiding, staying with us, like a guest coming to our house and we say, ah, welcome, welcome, welcome. Just a second. And we say, welcome, 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 come on in. We have a room here for you. Sit down at our table here and let's have dinner and let's just hang out together. That's the kind of condition we have to have. We have to welcome it in. The welcome mat has to be out. The room has to be there. And we have to be, you know, delighted and say, come on in. And we're not trying to say, oh, living light, you have come. Okay, now let's get to work transforming existence. No, we just, I see. This is the alternative to existence. The alternative. We don't try to dispossess existence of its characteristics. That would just cause things to get infinitely worse. Which is why, you know, the ego's very defenses of existence make things worse and worse and worse. In other words, a false plan of salvation seems to be dispossessing existence of its characteristics, which only cause the dream to expand and get more intense, to keep producing more forgetfulness, more worlds of delusion. It's incredible. The expansion of this universe is, the more we try and make this world better, the more that gives rise to worlds that are more severe loss, and the more we get entangled in that. It's just a non-stop entanglement, a vicious circle, really, totally vicious circle. The more we try to do good, the more we entangle ourselves in a vicious circle. The more we try and make existence our means of remembrance of what we are, the more we get entangled in deeper forgetfulness. So it's very despairing, really. But the living light, where there's no possibility of death whatsoever, the light itself is life. So where could there be death? What would cause death? There's only this light. This light is life itself. And you can't grasp it intellectually. I mean, my experience was such that I just said, wow. That's pretty much all I said. Oh my gosh, the light is alive. The light itself is alive, is life. What can harm it? Nothing. Can't be harmed. And so it was, you know, it's not something that can be intellectually grasped. I guarantee you that. But I can't talk about it and tell you that it is there. But we won't be aware of it until we have done the work, necessary work, to clear away the various defenses and reluctances and obstacles. Otherwise, if we don't do that work, we will continue on with the ego's path of salvation, trying to bring unity consciousness to existence, trying to work with consciousness. Consciousness is not life. That too is a symbol. That too is a symbol that we're dreaming. And as we continue on with this work, we don't realize it, but we're really enmeshing ourselves in backlashes and rebounds, and it's kind of like, you know, the idea of like, for instance, missionaries that are trying so hard to be good and bring the kingdom of heaven on this planet, and so they get sent out to, you know, some jungle somewhere among people with different beliefs, etc., that tend to be, can be very superstitious and a lot of taboos and very dangerous. They slave away in this jungle with all this horrible sicknesses and bugs and illnesses, and it's terrible for them, you know. And they say, but we're doing the Lord's work, and we're bringing unity to these consciousness, to these people, try to help them learn to integrate within the greater society of collective will and ideals, etc. And so they think they've done a whole lot of good. Okay. And then they come back, and what do they get? Someone says, wow, you're really good at this. I'm going to send you into an even more dark place, even more troubles there. So you get to go there. And on and on. The more you try to transform existence, you will find yourselves entering even worse and worse places. And it never ends, because the ego keeps, the dream keeps dreaming these places up for you. To maintain your forgetfulness of reality. To keep you deluded. And so the dream can simply dream more and more planets, more and more places for you to go work on. They say, well, you haven't succeeded yet, because look at this place. Look how terrible the people here are, all killing each other and eating each other. You need to go in there and teach the gospel to them. And so you do that, you know, and then next, wow, this place is even worse than that. You get to go there. Aren't you fortunate? Aren't you lucky? It's terrible. Existence is absolutely vicious and with no mercy. And all the while that we think that we're fixing existence, that we're transforming it, what we're really doing is we're just generating even more problems for us to solve. The more problems we think we're solving here, actually the more we're generating. We're just not aware of it, because our focus is so one-sided. We don't see both sides of the coin at all. And the problems that we're generating may not even be here on this planet. They can be. Oftentimes, unintended consequences, you know, the more we try to do good, the more actually things get even worse. It's very noticeable. But it's not only here. It's throughout the cosmos. We're actually generating, dreaming up worse problems to be faced with. It's kind of like we say, ah, we solved these problems here. Boy, here's some more. You must be really good at solving problems. Yeah, here's a whole heaping plate of more problems. It's like those competitive eaters, you know, they eat, you know, 50, you know, buffalo wings, and people say, wow, you're really great. Okay, here's 100. Let's see you eat 100 in 10 minutes. You know, it never ends. So we have to have some humor about this, really, really. We have to laugh at it because it is funny. Because when we see it, we just say, oh my gosh, all this time I thought I was saving the world, and all I was doing was generating other worlds that are even worse. More problems, more bodies, more suffering, more sicknesses. I mean, I've been having interesting dreams lately, where it seems like I'm having dreams of my experience with bodies in this world and all the sicknesses I've had. I think I've had a dream of bubonic plague. I had a dream last night, I think it was smallpox, my body having smallpox. And I know other sicknesses and illnesses that my bodies that maybe I've identified with have gone through on this planet, you know, horrible stuff. The people who are trying to bring about unity consciousness, I don't even think they're aware so much of what flesh has gone through on this planet. The flesh, yeah. Flesh goes through horrible, horrible sicknesses. And we think we're getting rid of those. We're not. If we were to generate, for instance, a planet that was free of sickness in existence, we would also be generating other planets, maybe many, in other places in the universe, full of bodies that are going through horrible, horrible illness and sickness. That is literally what we'd be doing. And we don't see that. We talk about the universe expanding. It expands this way. The more we try to solve problems, the more the universe expands. The more problems there are for us to work on. It's like the ego's terrified. The ego says, oh my gosh, you've gotten rid of smallpox here? Well, we gotta produce 10 planets that are, you know, full of smallpox or something like that. That's how it works. The more we try to wake up on the ego's path, the more the ego inundates us with forgetfulness. We take one step forward, we go two steps back. Things get worse, not better. The universe isn't getting better, it's getting worse. We may think that's a scary thing. No, it's not. Because by seeing it, we say, wow, I don't want that. It's a great thing to see it. It's not scary. I mean, it'd be scary if there was no alternative, right? But testimony through the ages is there is an alternative, so you can rest on that testimony, really. And intuitively, you know, deep down, you know there has to be. You know that you can't really separate from God and create a separate reality. You know you can't reverse the direction of creation. You know that reality is unharmed. Deep, deep down, you know it. So it's not like you're going to be totally panicked by anything that's been said here at all. No. The ego is going to be panicked, saying, oh my gosh, how do I counter this, you know? But what's being said here, it doesn't give rise to more planets, more problems at all, because it's not trying to transform existence, it's not trying to solve any problems. So it's not causing more problems to arise at all. It's simply allowing whatever problems there are in existence, let them be just the way they are. It's not trying to get rid of anything, but neither is it expanding the universe. It's not expanding the dream at all. It's not shrinking it either. It doesn't need to shrink it because there's an alternative. The living light, the world that the living light presents to us. No problems there, no sickness there at all. Nothing that needs to be solved. Simply, we take delight in it. And there's so many forms of delight. It's not like we're bored, not doing anything. We think if we're not solving problems, we're doing nothing. Not true. We are taking delight in so many different ways, you know, the essence of everything. Oh my gosh, that's so delightful. And this is so delightful. And this is so delightful. There's endless delight. So we're not bored just because we're not trying to unify the world or solve problems or figure out how to get rid of poverty or sickness or starvation or cut down on the birth rate or do all this stuff. Again, everything that all the problems we think we're solving, we're only generating more. Twice as much, maybe. Someplace, somewhere. We're just not aware of where, necessarily. But eventually we will run into it. Guess what? Solve the problems of this world. Here's a handful of new worlds that are full of problems. You got to solve those problems. And all the while you're being told that you're doing God's work. That somehow this is building up some super identity. That eventually you will reach the Godhead and be one with the Godhead. What we're really trying to do is become the Godhead by doing all this. Of course, we say we're going to share it. That's the rhetoric. But the fact is that our aim is to become the Godhead, become the prime creator through all this problem solving. We can feel, hey, I've got this universe. I've solved the problems on, billions of planets. I'm the God, the true Godhead, because I'm the one who solved all the problems. But guess what? You're never going to solve all the problems. You're only going to find exponentially more problems. So eventually you're going to run into a situation when you just say, oh my gosh, there's too many problems, I can't solve them. And then you're going to reach despair. And then you're going to pray mightily and say, isn't there any alternative to this? And then the living light will touch you. Just a little touch, a little kiss, a little touch. And you say, oh my gosh, there is an alternative. And then you'll know there is an alternative. And then you won't be so freaked out by all the problems, because you realize you don't have to solve them. It's a gradual realization. And, I'm unhappy that this teaching is not being taught around the world, really. It's very disappointing. I literally have spent my time looking at so many, 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 many teachers, and I'm disappointed, very disappointed that this type of teaching isn't taught more. It's just very, very seldom do you come across this, and maybe seems like it's vanishing. Because the false hope of high technology has spurred this enormous upsurge of belief in problem solving, which is ultimately belief that we can become Godhead. Let's not kid ourselves about that, even though we hide that fact and say, no, we're just doing God's work. This is what God wants us to do. We're becoming one with the Godhead, etc., etc. No, our goal is to become the Godhead by solving all these problems. There are no problems in reality. How can God possibly want the Son, the Spirit, to be solving problems? No such idea could possibly arise in reality. There are no problems. There's endless delight. There's endless experiencing of bliss and delight. That's reality. There's no problems. So how could we become Godhead by solving problems? Or how could we become one with Godhead by solving problems? It's not possible. We become one with Godhead by realizing there are no problems to solve in reality. And how do we remember that? By allowing the living light to present an alternative world to us, an alternative universe, even if we need that. Problem-free universe, problem-free world. And that's how we remember reality. It's not that we get to reality by solving problems, we get to reality by remembering there are no problems. But how do we do that if we're so accustomed to a scenario of problems, which is this world? This world is just like a vast problem generator, but we're still used to the world, the format, right? So the living light presents a real world to us. It still has a format of a world. It still seems to be a planet, I guess, and landscapes and water and lakes and rivers and trees and plants and, maybe animals, I don't know. It presents it in that format to us so we don't feel discontinuity. But there aren't any problems there. That's the one difference. It's not that you spend your time solving problems. So if if you're somebody who believes that your salvation depends on solving problems, the living light is not going to come to you and not going to present this to you, because that would freak you out completely. you look around in this real world and you say, oh my gosh, there are no problems to solve here. What do I do? I'm going to become completely bored, or even worse, I'm never going to be saved here because this can't serve my salvation, because my salvation depends on solving problems. And by doing that, pleasing the Godhead, and then therefore eventually becoming one with the Godhead. So those who have problem-solving consciousness literally take the real world as the ultimate hell. There's nothing there to serve their salvation, their quote-unquote enlightenment, which they see as coming through solving problems, through serving others, meaning solving problems of others. They wouldn't see anything. There's no possibility of that there at all. Zero. So, of course, they would reject it completely. So problem-solving consciousness rejects the real world out of hand immediately, completely. So they're not going to be touched by it. That consciousness is not going to be touched by the living light. I've been touched by it several times. And because I had a little bit of willingness to listen, to consider this, you know, not perfect willingness, but some, because I said, you know, let me get all the evidence here. I say something's not right in existence. There's something screwy with the whole thing. Doesn't add up somehow. You know, I feel like doesn't add up somehow. There's something that isn't right. So I said, okay, whoever has evidence, you know, let's present all the evidence. Let's take a look at the totality here. And so the living light came to me and saying, you know, this is some evidence you wanted to consider. All evidence, here is some evidence. And so I said, wow, now how do I fit that in with existence? And gradually I realized, you know, okay, so there's two different plans of salvation. There's one, there's the ego's plan, and there's God's plan. The ego's plan doesn't work, God's plan does work. So I gradually sorted it out. But because I was honest, and I said, you know, let's just let all evidence, if there are two sides, let both sides be presented. Let's give an honest appraisal, not an idealistic appraisal. Let's just be completely honest for a minute here. And let everyone have their say. In other words, if there's any alternative to this plan of existence, this plan of solving problems and transforming existence, let that also at least have their day in court. I was like a judge who was fair and said, let every plan have its day in court and speak up. I'm willing to listen. And then Living Light came to me and said, you know, this is God's plan of salvation. You consider this. And so I said, okay, I'll take this under consideration. I didn't immediately accept it. I said, okay, let's sort this out. You know, who's telling the truth? But if we just simply think that we know the truth already and think that transforming the world has to be the truth, that's total arrogance. We will not then allow the living light to even touch us. Or sometimes if we may have it, allow it to touch us, but then we won't, we'll say, I'm too busy to sort this out. I'm just going to try to use this as a way to motivate me to solve problems even more. That can happen. The living light does not refuse an invitation. It cannot guarantee that you will use that experience to turn to truth. Because if it refused an invitation, then you'd really be sunk, right? So there are some that ask for a moment to be honest, okay, present all alternatives. Living light presents and says, hello, here I am. And then they rebound from that and they say, I don't think that I can become a great motivator of the world if I teach this teaching. Therefore, I'm going to continue on with, it's more important, they think, to be, what they do is they say, first I'll become very famous as a famous spiritual teacher, and then I'll turn people to the light. But what doesn't work that way, does it? Because they keep selling out bit by bit by bit. And before too long, they realize their whole organization, everything is entirely in the grip of the ego. And if they were to speak up and say, this isn't it, people would just say, oh, you're suffering dementia or something. You know, it doesn't work. So what I did was I said, you know what, first, I'll find out the truth. And then, maybe I'll become a teacher. Maybe a lot of people listen to me, maybe no one will listen to me. But first, I'll sort it all out. Why? Because I've already been famous in a previous life. I think that's what saved me. I hated it, tell you the truth. Horrible. Fame in this world is a horrible thing. So when the living light came to me, you know, the idea of, oh, I could become a great guru, you know, in the world, I said, no. I don't want any fame. I don't want fame. Forget it. So if one's never had fame and the living light comes to them, the invitation goes out, it comes to them, I think it's very easy for them to say, oh my gosh, I could become extremely famous and I'll help a lot of people. And they have the right, ideally they think, you know, eventually I'll turn everybody towards the living light. But what happens is the organization they build up and all the people that come to them, all the motivation these people get is towards the ego's plan of salvation. So they'll generate an enormous push towards the ego's plan of salvation. And then when they say, okay, now how do I turn this all around? They're sunk. They say, I can't. You know, they say, oh, this is horrible. And then they just kind of lapse into, you know, feebleness, you know, at some point. They just say, oh my gosh, didn't work. But I was saved from that because I had already been extremely famous in a previous life, and I had people coming, you know, strangers coming to me all the time. I was sought out constantly, and I just wanted to escape from the public, because the public is nuts. Honestly, I mean, the ego's plan of salvation just generates insanity, you know, and they just, can I get your autograph, you know. Gosh, you know, I said, no, I don't want to use this to be famous. I will spend my life sorting this out first. And if I get it all sorted out, then I will say something about it. And if nobody listens, you know, so be it. I'm not seeking fame. If it comes, I'll have to put up with it. If millions of people say, "Oh, you're teaching correctly. This is what I want," then I'll have to deal with it. I probably could deal with it fine. I've already been through that whole fame thing, so you know, take it or leave it. Really, I don't like it, but I could probably put up with it for a while. But the fact is that you know, what I see is that very, very few turn in this direction. Really, very, very few. So, as I'm explaining, the teachers you see in this world, what I'm observing is that they, for a moment, they were honest. And they said, let me be honest for a moment. And then the living light touches them. It has to. Again, if they had true openness and honesty, which they have, were capable of that, and the living light didn't touch them, then they would conclude there's no such thing. And then they would really be lost. And accept the ego's plan wholeheartedly, you know. What happens is that so the living light has to respond to our honesty, our honest invitation, has to. It touches them, they're touched by it. And then they think they see a way to popularize this on a grand scale. And what happens is then they end up accommodating the ego's plan, thinking that they'll be able to somehow translate that to God's plan down the road. And they end up actually making things worse on the planet because all these people say, ah, this teacher, look, they're teaching transformation on the world, and they get a whole bunch more people coming in. So before you know it, there's millions of people following this great guru, and they're all teaching, you know, transformation on the world, unity, let's solve the problems on the world, this is what the teacher wants us to do, and we're fired up. Makes things much, much, much worse. Generates, you know, other places of extreme problems. And again, I was saved from this because I'd already been famous. Already been extremely well known and had had, the accolades and large organizations thinking that I could help transform the world. Countries thinking I could transform the world, thinking that, hey, this guy has a capability to really help us with this process of transforming the world. And so I've been through that, and I realized the futility of it, how it didn't work, and how badly I suffered, and how fame is really a very nasty thing. So I wasn't tempted to push this out on a grand scale. I mean, there was some temptation, but not enough. My primary goal was to sort it all out. So that's what I did. In other words, instead of going out and holding satsang or whatever, and just people saying, wow, this guy's been touched by the living light, and therefore we're going to come to him, and then accepting whatever those who came to me wanted me to say to them, like, let's transform the world, I said, forget that, not interested. Let's spend all my time sorting it out. So spent decades and decades and decades sorting it out. Just sitting, like I'm sitting right here, just sitting on a, sitting in a chair, just quietly sorting it out. That's all that I did, sorting it out. Say, who's telling the truth? Is the living light telling the truth, or the ego telling the truth, or are they both telling the truth? Because the ego will tell you when it starts losing ground. First, it'll tell you that it's telling the truth. Then, if you start getting suspicious, it'll tell you that both are telling the truth. And then, eventually, you realize the ego's lying. That's how it goes. So it's tough, because first of all, you're faced with believing strongly that the ego's plan of salvation, of transforming the world, it must be true. And then you start having doubts, and then the ego starts shifting over, saying, well, both of these are true, you just have to integrate them. And you go through a long period of looking at all this, how to integrate, is that true? And that seems to be the higher truth. The ego will tell you, well, there is a higher truth, and that's integrating everything. And so you have to look at that, and eventually you see that's a lie too. And then you realize that truth and lies can't both be true. They can't be integrated. The ego's path is a lie. God's plan, living light, is true. And you can either choose between those two alternatives. But sorting it out is very difficult. And if you're out there trying to be a guru and a teacher and a spiritual leader, etc., you don't have the time to sort it out. You are inundated with the demands of the devotees, etc., giving them hope. And what are they coming for? They're trying to learn how to transform the world. So they're coming to you, asking you, demanding of you, give them the motivation to transform the world. So how can you tell them, no, you need to sit in a chair for 30 years and sort out and figure out and see what is true and what is not true? They're going to say, no, that doesn't serve their path at all, because they believe they're building an identity through service, through solving problems of the world. That's how they build their identity. So if they're sitting in a chair for 30 years, they think it's 30 years wasted, and they're going to be on the bottom. Their identity is going to dissipate, or their hope for identity, their union with Godhead, is going to be severely retarded, they think, if they do that. So it's terrible. It's a very frightening thing to do. What I did was scary, because everyone tacitly was saying, doing this is, you are literally going to end up on the bottom. You'll be the last one to be one with Godhead, or you may even fail entirely. And so there's that feeling like, is sorting this out, the right thing to do? Now, A Course in Miracles said it is the right thing to do. Examine your value of the world, sort out what is true and what is lies, and realize they can't both be true. And Jesus told us, said, this can take a long time. It can be a lot of work. So, and again, my aversion to fame helped me greatly. So these spiritual teachers in the planet, and these movers and shakers, etc., at some point, maybe in the next lifetime, they will sort it out, because they won't want to do it again. They'll say, wow, I'm not going through that again. No way. No way. They will have an aversion to fame, and they'll say, forget it. Something's wrong. Didn't work. I'm not going to go through that path again. And then they'll honestly say, okay, let me be aware of all the facts, and then they'll be touched again by living light. And they'll say, this is familiar, this living light is familiar, okay. But I'm not going to be a teacher of no, forget it, forget that. Let me just, what do I do then? If I'm not going to be a teacher, what do I do? I can inquire and sort it out and figure out what's true. Can both of these be true, you know? And then they'll spend the time sorting it out. And maybe once they do sort it out, then they will teach, but they probably won't be famous. Maybe even nobody will listen to them. Because there's not many, it's a terrifying thing in this world, because we literally believe if we don't work towards transformation, we are not working towards our establishing identity for ourselves. Because existence doesn't establish a debt. There's no identity here for us. So we think we have to establish an identity. The flesh isn't, there's no identity. Identity is not something that's temporary, right? How can you speak of temporary identity? That's a contradiction in terms. It's a contradiction in meaning. Identity means what you are, period. What is? This is what I am, you know. So how can you build an identity on a body? Body's temporary. How can you build identity on anything in existence? Everything here is temporary. So you can only build identity in existence on the belief in a future identity that you're working towards accomplishing it. And then you have to come up with a plan that seems plausible. You can accomplish this. And solving the problems of the world is that plan that we're somehow developing an identity, you know, unity consciousness or something is going to be an identity. It's like we realize that we can't build it on this body because it's going to die. But somehow if we build it on all bodies, that is going to work. I mean, totally verklempt idea, isn't it? Nonsense. Of course, all bodies are going to die. So how does building a unity on collective bodies going to work? We just don't even think about, you know, how stupid that is. Because all bodies are going to die. Well, we build it then on future bodies. That a non-stop stream of bodies, you know, will continue on and on and on. Not realizing that there's no such thing as a body that doesn't die. So it doesn't matter if this stream of bodies has gone on for billions of years. There's still no, we can't build an identity, we can't find an identity on that. We just have to keep this stream of bodies going, which is why the ego is so insistent on producing more and more bodies. Gotta have more bodies. Gotta keep more bodies, the better. Gotta keep these bodies coming because our identity depends upon it. You know, our plausible future identity depends on nonstop bodies. If you look at it, you just say, wow, there's something really messed up about this whole thing. As if identity could come from bodies. Unity identity, unity consciousness coming from bodies. Resting on that. Cannot. Contradiction in terms. So, but we are intimidated by, you know, say, I can't find an identity. I don't feel identity, which nobody does here. When I got things twisted around trying to help people, I lost a feeling of any identity. I said, who am I? I don't know who I am. I look at this world. I used to see the real world. And then I gradually flipped over into seeing existence. And when I did, I didn't know who I was. And so how can I find my identity? And that's how I began listening to all these spiritual teachers supposedly teaching me, you know, how to find my identity. You need to do service. Seva, you know. Serve all. Feed the poor, you know. Clothe the poor, feed them. Be a researcher. Cure an illness. Whatever. Do all this stuff. You'll eventually find yourself. You'll find your identity. said, wow, really? And I said, well, what about the identity that I just misplaced somehow? Oh, and he goes, oh, yeah. Oh, so I see. You're one of those really advanced spiritual aspirants. Okay. Well, the ego said, well, what you need to do is then integrate that with everything that's going on here. Integrate it. See, as soon as the ego finds out that you've had a taste of reality, then it goes, oh, it flatters you and says, oh, I see. You are one of these very, very old souls, very advanced souls. So I'm going to tell you the real truth. You know, integration, you get to integrate it. That's the truth. That's how you'll find your identity. In other words, integrate truth and lies, and then you'll find your identity. Whoopee, whoopee. Aren't you fortunate? You're one of the fortunate ones, the ego says. And then you try that, and it doesn't work. You say, wait a minute, someone's not telling the truth. That's, you know, eventually you realize that someone's not telling the truth. Who is it? Who's not telling the truth? And then the ego desperately tries to distract you from finding out the answers to this. Desperately. Throws everything at you. The ego will say, oh, but bodies are so much fun, you know. I'll give you a kingdom, you know, full of bodies, all worshiping of you. Just keep trying to integrate, you know. You don't realize how enjoyable body identity is, you know. So it'll, you know, offer you up a harem or whatever it takes. A vast nonstop party, you know, a vast bacchanalian life, if you only you just keep trying to integrate, you know, whatever, it'll just promise you anything to keep trying to integrate truth and lies instead of realizing that truth and lies can't both be true. So it why? Because the ego doesn't want you to realize you have a choice. Once you realize you have a choice, you know, the ego is finished. Once you see you need to choose between one plan or the other plan, not integrate them. Then you say, ah, I have a choice. Which one do I want? Right? Then, you know, the ego's days are numbered at that point. Which one do I want? That's all. All you get to choose which one do you want. Which one do you enjoy? Which one makes you happy? In one, you don't have a sense of identity, and you're in desperate struggle to find an identity. And one, you realize you have this glorious, imperishable, fantastic, perfect, flawless identity. Now, the ego will tell you that the identity that it's telling you you're working towards is going to be greater than the identity that the living light will show you. That's what the ego will say to you. That's all that it can say to you. It's a trump card. What else can it say? What else can it say? Because it certainly, right now, cannot offer you an identity that is equal to what the living light can offer you. Living light can offer you perfect identity right now. The ego can only promise you a greater identity in the future. Okay, let's listen. Let's pay attention to this, please. The ego cannot offer you an equal identity right now to what the living light can offer. Okay, we heard that, but there's one more aspect to this. If the ego were to tell you that it can offer you something equal to what the living light can offer you as far as identity, but that it can't offer you it now, but it can offer it to you in the future. Okay. What kind of deal is that? Let's say somebody, two people, and you say, I need some money, and one says, here's $100, here's $100. And the other one says, I don't have anything to offer you right now. I don't have any money, but 10 years from now, I'll be able to offer you $100 as well. You know, what's the better offer? I mean, aren't you going to take the $100 now? If you're not getting anything any better by waiting, why would you choose that? So the ego has to say it can give you something better, a better identity in the future. Has to say that. Otherwise, the ego will be exposed entirely as having nothing to offer you. The ego can't offer you identity right now. And so all I can say is, well, the reason I'm not offering it to you right now is because I'm working on something better. If the ego said, I can offer you the same identity, just as good, but it'll take, you know, 1 million years, you're going to say, why should I wait 1 million years if I can get the exact same thing right now? Very easy to see through that, right? Very, very easy to see through that. So that would not be a problem for us. What the ego does is it says, the reason why it can't offer you perfect identity right now is because it is working on developing something even better. And that if you just wait, it will give you something better. That is its offer. Every single one of us is being offered that. If you really put the ego, you know, straight out, okay, what's your offer? That's what it will say. So, you know, then you have to consider whether that's true or not. That's the hard part. That's what takes the time sorting this out on the spiritual path, is you have to consider, is that true or not? And then eventually you come to a conclusion that it's a lie. It's a necessary lie the ego tells you. That's all it's got. That's its trump card. But if you see through its trump card, what does it have? Nothing. But you do have to see through its trump card. That is, you know, that is a fact. You do see, have to see through the trump card. Otherwise, you'd say, why should I accept an identity right now if I could have a better one later? And of course, the ego tells you if you accept this identity that the living light's offering you now, that the ego is going to cut you out of the future superior identity. Because you're disloyal. Yeah, it has to tell you that, right? Otherwise, you just say, okay, well, I'll accept the perfect identity the living light is offering me right now. And when you come up with something better, okay, get back to me then. So the ego says, no, 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 I can't do it that way. Because you have to work on developing this new identity. And if you are accepting this perfect identity the living light is offering you, you won't work on it. You'll be a slacker. And the ego tells you, nobody who's a slacker will receive this superior identity. Only those who have done the work can get it. And if you accept the perfect identity now, you won't do the work. So you're out of luck. So that, you know, it's very intimidating that way. Very intimidating. And you say, uh-oh. You know, uh-oh, I better, I don't know what I better do. It's kind of scary. So the ego, you know, scares us this way. It scares us. Terrifies us, you know, and we struggle on the spiritual path trying to figure out which way to go. Do I hang in there and keep working on this, developing this super identity, or do I accept that the perfect identity is available to me right now? We're all in that same boat. The only difference is how much work we've done on sorting this out. That's the only difference there is between any of us. You want to have oneness, then realize we're all in the same boat of sorting out this offer. That's how we're all the same. We're all the same that way. We're all trying to sort out this offer. Some are doing it very little work on it, some are doing a lot of work on it. But eventually everybody will sort it out. They have no choice but to, because the ego's lying. There is no other identity. We can't create an identity. We don't have the power or authority to create an identity. The Prime Creator created identity. And that identity, we have the power to extend that identity. We don't have the power to create it. So the only identity there is the one that has always been and is perfect right now. Whatever says you have to wait to experience identity is a lie. And it doesn't have any identity to offer you. Identity was present, has always been present, eternally present, always is. There's no such thing as identity that is not now. No such thing. So, if whatever cannot offer you identity now has none to offer you, and never will, and never will, never will. So the ego is lying. And basically, satsang is basically just to help us see that the ego is lying. It's not easy. You know, there's always some seed of doubt, right? But we have to realize that what we're doing is we're trying to create identity, and we don't have that power. We're not Prime Creator. Because Prime Creator is identity. Identity is eternal. It's never ending. It's endless. So how could we be in the process of creating identity? That is just nuts. It's a complete denial of reality, really. If we can see it that way, it's helpful. It is a complete denial of reality. What we're doing is we're totally denying reality. And that is something we can see. We can realize that. And so really it boils down to, are we going to believe that we can completely deny reality? Or are we going to believe that is just won't get us anywhere? It boils down to that. I mean, it boils down to what we want. Do we want to remain in a state of denying reality or not? We can always assert that we can create identity. That we can always assert it as plausible, but that is a complete denial of reality, and that's all that it is. It's not anything other than that. And we can remain in this logic of plausibility, but truthfully, it's only a denial of reality, which is, what is it? Nothing. A denial of reality is really nothing. And it boils down to that. And satsang is just this boiling. You know, we put on a tea kettle on the stove and we, you know, turn the gas up, maybe medium flame, and just boil, let it boil. Just sit there and let the teapot boil. Boil off this delusion. Let it boil away. Boil it all down to its essence. What is the, you know, essence? Essentially, or simply arrogantly denying reality. Denying identity. And we do this by saying, oh no, we're in the process of creating identity. And we say this in a different way. We say we're in the process of making our identity one with the Godhead, etc. That is just, you know, circumventing. That is just a slick way. That is denying identity. Because identity, by its very definition, has to be present right now. Identity, if there is true identity, it is always true. It is always one. It cannot separate from itself. So in other words, reality is identity. So you cannot have a situation where you are quote unquote merging into identity or something. You know, that's just a slick marketing tactic the ego is using. But really, it's exactly the same delusion. It's still denial. It's just a, you know, a clever form of denial. Reality is not any merging of identities. It is the extension of the one identity. That is. There's no break in continuity whatsoever with that. There's no little identities merging into a big identity. There's no process of building up an identity. There is one identity, eternal, invulnerable, flawless, that is extending itself. And anything other than that is a dream, a delusion, is a denial of it. Denial of truth, denial of reality. And denials have no power over identity. There is nothing outside of identity to oppose it. So identity is not opposed by anything. A dream of denial is not an opposition to identity. It's just simply nothing. So we were basically spending our time believing in nothing. Sleeping, you know. Let's say we go out in the midday and we're feeling sleepy and we lie down on a bench and we take a nap, you know, and we're sleeping. Does that, when we're asleep and we're not aware of like the sun, does that mean the sun has vanished, is gone? No. That's like saying if there's a, you know, tree falls in the forest and there's no one there to hear it, does it make a sound? You know, of course it does. That's like saying if we're in a forest and we're asleep, we go to sleep and a tree falls and we don't, or we're not aware of the sound, does that mean the sound was not produced? Of course it was produced. The fact that we are unaware of reality, or at least we're professing to be unaware, does that mean the reality is not there? We're professing to be unaware of identity. Does that mean identity isn't there? No, of course not. Of course it's there. It's just that we have perfect freedom, so we have the freedom to deny freedom. You see, freedom wouldn't be perfectly free if it didn't have the freedom to deny freedom. So that freedom is there too. We are literally free to claim we are not free. But that doesn't establish non-freedom. It just is part of the freedom, okay? We are perfectly free, which means we are free to claim we're not free. We're free to make that claim, but that does no way does that impinge upon our freedom. So that's a very simple explanation. So we did that. We said, I want to make sure that we're really totally free, so let us exercise our freedom to believe that we're not free. So, okay, so the scenario of denial of freedom arose. Denial of identity, denial of reality arose. And we're enmeshed in this, and all these defenses have arisen to defend this lack of freedom. And we say we're becoming free. how is it that in perfect freedom we're in a process of becoming free? Wouldn't that establish the fact that we're not free right now if we're becoming free? Of course it would. Come on, we're not stupid. You know, one thing we are not is we're not stupid. We can play dumb, which many do. All degrees. I've come across many, many different. Everyone's playing dumb here, really. To some extent, some more than others, but we are not dumb. We're not stupid. We're not so stupid we cannot see the obvious folly of our position that we're in. We just have to look at it, and it's funny when you see it. It's humorous. You really smile and laugh because it is really. We just say, "Oh, we're just playing dumb." That's what we were doing. It was always completely obvious, you know. So it's actually, we don't get mad at ourselves. We kind of chuckle. It's funny. If we are becoming free, doesn't that automatically mean that we don't believe we are free right now? Of course it does. Of course it does. If we are becoming an identity, doesn't that mean we don't have one now? Of course it does. Of course it's saying that. And yet we're overlooking that. We're saying, I don't see that. And I say, oh, I don't see it. I don't see that. I don't see it. What are you talking about? That's just plain dumb. And then when we give up playing dumb, it's funny. We kind of laugh and say, ah, that was pretty stupid, wasn't it? That's very stupid. It's so stupid, it's funny. That's the thing. And it's inconsequential, so it's funny. Denying our freedom doesn't make us unfree. Believing that we're fixing freedom, that we're healing freedom, is funny. Doesn't mean that freedom needs to be fixed or it needs to be healed, or that we're fixing our identities, we're healing our identities. Doesn't mean that our identity needs to be fixed or healed. It's just the same old, you know, denial of what is real, what is true. You know, the Indians have a tradition. They say, you know, namaste, or like that. They kind of bow to each other. They don't hug each other from one body to the other. Let me hug the flesh, you know, or something. That's a good tradition. It arose out of a lot of wisdom throughout the ages that has arisen in India. You know, it's like this. Namaste, peace to you, peace to you. It's a much better way, you know, like this, you know. That's another way you can say that. Wonderful to see you. Wonderful to see you. Wonderful to see you. Hello, peace. That's a very proper thing to do, really. Or, you know, shaking hands is also, you don't shake hands much, but grasping of hands. But, you know, less physical contact is actually better. Say, because it's not about the physical at all. It's not about anything remotely related to the physical at all. It's not related to the person. Awakening is not related to the person. It's not related to human being. Not at all. Not even the tiniest bit. And yet we can keep those conventions for the sake of continuity. The Living Light understands that. Again, I said that we can believe that, you know, we still have a world and maybe we even still have a body. Possible. But it's not about that. It's about experiencing problem freeness, pure delight, constant delight, not having to solve any problems, not having to establish any identity. It's about that. So it's for the sake of pointing towards that. It's better to, if one has to give some greeting, you know, it's better to just, you know, like that, you know. It's not, oh, give me a hug, oh, I love you so much, give me a hug, you know, let me feel, you know, the identity of your body, let me get the feel, I want to be reassured that you share the same goal as me is. You know, creating some bodily identity or something like that. No, it's better to say, look, you share the same goal of not trying to create a bodily identity, not trying to create identity, rather accepting remembrance of that one identity that always is. That's better. The one identity that is, always is, that is not in a process of becoming. It's not increasing itself. It's expanding. That's different. It's different. The quality is the same. It's just simply expanding its delight. All right. Endlessly expanding its delight. That is reality. But the identity is one. Always. Always one. Always present. And that identity is freedom. Freedom to expand into light. That is identity. So that always remains the same. The freedom has been there from the very beginning. The expansion of identity has been from the very beginning. The laws of creation were there from the very beginning and always will be there. So those don't change at all. Freedom doesn't, you don't become more free. How can you become more free than perfect freedom? You don't become more one. How can you become more one than perfect oneness? You don't become more capable of expansion because you've always been capable of expansion. You know, on that one, I don't know. I might modify that slightly because maybe you do expand more and more and more and more, but it's still expansion. I mean, your capability, the fundamental capability to expand doesn't change. The fundamental capability of delight doesn't change. The fundamental fact that you're not threatened doesn't change. The fundamental fact that you're invulnerable doesn't change. The fundamental fact that this creation goes on endlessly doesn't change. None of that changes at all. It's all there from the very beginning. And is cannot be altered in any way. The whole idea, the ego says, no, we're making it better. That's the big lie. Because what it means is it's being altered. Which means it wasn't perfect from the very beginning. I mean, how can you have anything make it more perfect, more than 100%? Not really. I mean, if, in other words, creation is endless, how can you change that and make it more? Can you really? Or if you have perfect freedom, how can you be working on making that better? You cannot. It's a lie. The ego's lying. The ego is lying, and satsang points that out, that the ego is lying. Now I look like the Geico Neanderthal there or something. There you go. It's the Geico. It's the Neanderthal. It's so simple. Even a caveman could understand it. That is true. Truth is so simple that even a caveman could understand it. Which is true. It really is that simple. And even a goddess could understand it. So simple. Even a goddess can understand it, or a god could understand it. Or a dakini, or some sort of subtle spiritual being. The truth is so simple, even they can understand it. So you don't have to be some airy, you know, subtle being or something. You know, you can also be a caveman and or a cavewoman, and you can understand truth. You can understand. You can understand it too, because we just realize that it's so perfectly simple, really. And even in between, like as we're here on this world now, maybe we're not, you know, cave people, and we may not be these real hip fourth dimensional beings or all socially connected and got all these plans for oneness. We can understand it right now. I can understand it right now. You know, it's pretty simple once you look at it. It's not impossible. just giving time. We're not in any hurry to force anything on anybody, you know. Okay, folks, now that we've told the truth, it's time to jump into the pool, you know. Okay, campers. We're not campers, you know. Okay, campers, I've shown you what we're gonna do, and okay, let's dive into the pool. Come on, everybody go, let's go. No. You got time to let it settle in. That's a valuable part of satsang, is the time to let it settle in. No pressure. Take stock of your surroundings. You know, is the boogeyman coming to get you? No. Is the wrath of God, you know, coming to get you? No. There's no wrath in God, God whatsoever. That's all the ego. It's the wrath of existence. Of course there's wrath in existence. There's endless wrath of existence. But God didn't make existence, see? Existence, we made it up. It's our dream. Of course, in our dream of trying to forget what we are and trying to deny reality, there's a tremendous amount of wrath. It's very wrathful. Tremendous appetite for destruction in our dream, of course. And so forget about pleading with the deity of existence, which is none other than ourselves. To, you know, we don't want so much wrath. Can you get rid of the wrath? Can you get rid of the destruction? Can you do this? Waste of time. Wherever the cleanup seems to take place, more trouble is taking place somewhere else, and you will not escape that trouble. You will inevitably run into it. So don't waste time pleading for healing or safety or all this. I know we cannot entirely get away from it. I guess this is the caveman adjustment we got here. So, the situation is exactly the same if you got some teacher, some guru teaching, you know, giving satsang. The truth is exactly the same for them as it would be for, you know, a caveman 10,000 years ago trying to figure out how to kill that woolly mammoth. The truth still is because it was exactly the same then as it is now. It never changes. And we can even oscillate between these two states of being, states of existence here. And we do oscillate. We put ourselves through this and try to develop from here, this low level of consciousness, develop it up to a, you know, higher level of consciousness. Truth is exactly the same. It's always exactly the same. We're still in this, you know, trying to deny reality. And there's still the living light has a real world for us to that we can choose to experience. And then that, once we experience that and get really comfortable there, then it gets translated back into, you know, our full-on delight of existence. Of reality. Our full-on delight of reality. Reality is just this full-on delight expanding, you know, continuously. And we're so used to not doing that, that we need kind of, we're afraid of a break in continuity, so we need this, the real world, to experience it. And it's that our delight seems to be somewhat circumscribed by the area that we're in. You know, it's like we're on a planet. We say, well, I can only have so much delight because I'm on this planet. Whereas in reality, there are no planets. It's a seamless tapestry where the delight is multidimensional, infinitely dimensional, so to speak, in all directions, flowing and expanding, and it's beyond anything we can imagine, really. Our imagination can give a faint approximation of this. Very, very, very faint, and it's not enough. So we need the real world. We need this a situation where everywhere we look, we're delighted. See, I'm so delighted with what I see. And yet, We still have a body and we're still looking at things, so our delight seems to be at least contained by the practicality of that fact. You know, like here, I can take a walk down the street and I see all these homes and yards, and I say, oh, how delightful. That's so delightful. That's so nice. That's so delightful. It's kind of like in the real world, it's like we'll be just, you know, walking and seeing everything we see is so delightful. And yet, we're limited by what we're seeing by our fact that we're walking along or, you know, maybe floating along. We can float along as well. And, so we won't feel overwhelmed by the delight. Won't get frightened. Once we get very used to, maybe first we'll walk and then we'll float and then we'll fly and then we'll expand our delight gradually. And then at some point we'll say, we'll be unafraid to pure delight, meaning complete multidimensional delight with no limits, unlimited. That is beyond the scope of what we can imagine or talk about right now. As a goal, because first we have to get used to nothing but delight, even though the amount of delight may not be as much, the intensity. We do have to get used to everything we see is delightful. We have to get used to that first. And the real world gives us that everything we see is delightful. No, there's no sickness, no death, no harm, no vulnerability, nothing. Everything we see is delightful. We're just, Ananda Mahima was in total bliss all the time. In delightfulness. She had this mood of complete delightfulness at all times. Everything she saw was delightful. We can do the same. We can, in the real world, everything we see is delightful. No such thing as tragedy. We're not viewing tragedy anymore. No such thing. Everything is delightful. That's the only way we can get back, drop our denial of reality and function the way we are created to function, which is endless, eternal delight in all directions, multidimensional. It's the only way, really. Only practical way. We can't just leap from no delight into this pure delight. We would think it would be overwhelming. It wouldn't overwhelm us, but it seems as if it would from our standpoint. So we need this intermediate step of a real world where everything is delightful and yet we're not experiencing, that's somewhat limited our experiencing. And then gradually we get used to that and then it gets translated into pure delight in all multidimensional, you know, even beyond multidimensional as it were. That's how it really works. That is the true gospel. And so I'm just sharing this here because it's been shared with me. The awareness of this has been shared. I've become aware of this bit by bit by bit, gradually working on it constantly. You know, the basic parameters have come into view. And so we're able to, you know, share this time listening to this and getting tuned into it. It's kind of like, you know, like there's some concert somewhere and somebody finds out about it. Let's say, you know, when I was, you know, teenage, young, the big thing was talented musicians. And we're always trying to find, like, we hear there's some hot musician somewhere, really great guitar player. That was the thing, a great guitar player. And we're always looking for, you know, great guitar player. Can we go listen to him? And they're all, you know, at that time, everybody had a garage band. So there were thousands of guitar players, you know, in the Bay Area, maybe hundreds of thousands. And so we're always looking for that band, you know, that hot band. Is there some band out there that's like totally insanely great? And you hear rumors, you know. And if somebody, you know, hears of this band, maybe they're like rehearsing in a garage somewhere. I mean, you go down the street at that time and you'd see bands in their garages. I played in garage bands. play here, play there, play in garages and homes. That's what we did. All over. And so let's say you're traveling down a street and you hear this band, you stop and you park your car and you come on in, they let you listen. You listen. And what if you heard this incredible garage band that like the guitar player was just like out of this world great? What would you do? You'd go back and tell your friends, you'd say, Hey, you know, a couple of friends, hey, you know, you won't believe this, but I know this band that's like totally hot, unbelievable, you'll blow your mind, it's so great. Yeah. And they say, oh, really? Where? I said, yeah, I know where they are. Where? Well, there's a street over in such and such a town. Say, how'd you find out? I was driving by. Oh, really? Wow. I say, hey, you want to go? They said I could bring a couple of my friends along. They say, yeah, let's go. So we'd get in the car, and we'd go over, and we'd listen to the garage band. That's pretty much how Van Halen, you know, started, just like that. And then more people tell other people. They say, hey, there's this really incredible band, and, you know, we should check them out. And gradually, by word of mouth, this little garage band that nobody knew about gets known. And so we were always wanting to tell our friends about the best stuff we found, you know. That's what it was like, and it's probably like that now, still. So I was always exploring, trying to find the best stuff, and I'd tell my friends, hey, you know, I found this really great stuff, or they'd tell me something. So when you find out about truth, you find out about the real world, when you find out about the living light, you want to tell your friends, and you want to say, hey, you know, I discovered there's this living light, and there's this real world, and we can actually experience it, and that frees us from the ego delusion of existence, and you want to tell people about it. Say, come on, you know, so that's, it doesn't mean that I'm the player, you know, just because I'm telling my friends about this really great garage band, that doesn't mean I'm in the band. Not in the band, you know, I'm not producing the music, I'm not producing the real world, you know, the living light, God, the prime creator, Holy Spirit, is producing the real world, ultimately, since I'm, there's only one identity. That one identity is producing the real world, which means we all are producing it, so to speak, because we're all one identity. But it's not this person, this dream figure that's producing the real world. I'm just saying, hey, we can go there and experience delight, which is when we're listening to GarageBand, we're trying to experience delight. I used to play for people in GarageBand, and some, you know, people would come. But, you know, it wasn't good enough so that it built up like Van Halen built up, something like that. I mean, Van Halen's an example of, you know, like a musical talent that really was superior. So people would say, wow, you can't believe this. You go listen to this. I mean, it's incredible. There were just bands everywhere. Most of them were, you know, so-so. Some were good. We had a guitar player at our high school that was superior. Really superior. I used to go to his house and just listen to him play. He was fabulous. I haven't heard him in maybe 20 years, but I came across him one day and playing for a small shopping center, and he was still fabulous, just incredibly good. But what are we getting in music? We're trying to get this flow of delight, right? So music's like a substitute. It's how we try to keep ourselves loyal to existence. We're trying to get that flow of delight. But in the real world is way more profound than music. It touches you deeper, because I've experienced the real world for a brief time. And I've also experienced the best that music has to offer. I was a complete music freak, aficionado, to the ultimate extent. You know, that was my entire life. My whole life was music. So I've experienced, you know, fabulous, fabulous music. Sometimes I played some that was pretty darn good. And it doesn't compare. Does not compare. The greatest concert on this planet that there'll ever be, with the greatest musicians and the greatest audience, does not compare at all. Doesn't measure up at all to experiencing the real world. Because the delight there touches you at a much, much deeper level. through and through. It like permeates you. And the permeation is profound and steady and supportable. And you realize, and stable, you know. So it's you cannot compare the two, really. One is like a speck of dust, you know. One is a candle, one is like a sun, you know, that kind of thing. But it's important to point out, in music, we are searching for that stream, that flow of delight, you know. You got these musicians that are just grooving, you know, and they're just pouring out these sounds, and you're just trying to feel the delight of it, you know. Like, oh, okay, I'm in this flow of delight. And people take drugs to try and enhance this flow of delight, both the musicians and the audience. That's what they're doing. They're trying to get this feeling of this flow of delight, which is the way reality is here in existence. But it's crummy. It's gunky. You know, it's not it. When you experience the real world, then you experience this flow of delight, and there's no after effects. It's fresh, it's clean, it's pure, it's immaculate, it's timeless, will always be there. You know, it's not like Woodstock. After the party's over, you gotta clean up all that garbage. It's not all these people dying and overheating and this massive humanity, you know, sweltering there and grooving and stuff. No, there's no garbage to clean up. There's no leaves to clean up. There's no defacing of anything. Nothing's defaced. Whatever delight you experience there is repeatable, completely repeatable. You can't lose it. Nobody can steal it. It's like if you had this, like, you know, an album or a cassette or an 8-track or a CD or a DVD of some great, great band, you know, and you say, I can listen to it over and over and over and over, which I did. You know, but, you know, somebody can steal it. Your DVD player can break. Your CD player can break. The CD can get scratched. You can lose it. Again, someone can steal your collection. You can misplace it. A lot of stuff can happen to it. You yourself can be sick, can become sick. Your hearing can go bad, etc., etc., etc. In the real world, none of that can happen. The experiencer can't get sick. The experience cannot get stolen, cannot get misplaced, cannot get lost. So there is this feeling of solidity and stability and permanence and effortlessness, etc., that whole thing lends a feeling of so profound and so grateful. It touches you in a place of gratitude that the world cannot touch you in. The world cannot touch you this way. Doesn't matter how great the musicians are. You know, Eric Clapton cannot touch you in this way. It's impossible. People used to say Clapton is God, you know. We grew up with that. Eric Clapton is God. He's very, very talented musician, but he's not God. You know, he cannot give you the experience of the real world, cannot give you that same experience at all. Nobody can here. No one, no artist in existence could ever give you that feeling. Compared to it, all they're giving you is just absolute junk. Like a gaudy little plastic trinket or something, you know. That's the very best. So don't waste your time trying to be a great musician. That's the moral of the story too. And don't go waste your time chasing after great musicians and great music. Not that you will stop doing that, but at least realize that that will never be the answer. That the experience of the real world, the problem-free world, this immaculate world, is so much, much, much better. You enjoy it so much more than the very best music or art you could ever experience, or the best relationship you could ever experience. There's another thing. Some people chase after music, great, and other people chase after great relationships in this world. Same thing. The very best relationship anyone could ever have here is like junk, nothing compared to how you feel when you experience the real world. Because you realize that everything there is ceaselessly there for you. You have a total perfect relationship with everything there. It's there for you. Will always be there for you. And you will always be there for it. That's true relationship. That's what real relationship means. And in this world, you can never have that. You cannot guarantee that the relationship you're having right now will always be there for you, no matter how great you might think it is. You know, you may be strolling on a you know, tropical beach. You might be listening to beautiful music being played, the flow of beautiful music. The breeze may be beautifully flowing. You know, your hearts may be one and all this stuff. But how permanent is it? Can you guarantee that the one you're in relationship with isn't going to meet someone that offers them a better flow or something? Or that they won't get sick? Or that some catastrophe or accident might happen? Or on and on and on and on and on, and you're both going to die, etc. Now, there's no permanence there. When you experience the real world, there's permanence. That flower there, you know it's always going to be there for you. You know it. And that feeling you get realizing it's always going to be there for you is an incredible feeling. You can never get that feeling here in this world. Even the sun is not going to always be there. People try to worship the sun as a sign of permanence. Okay, sun worshipers. I used to be kind of this way. I had a tinge of that sun worship because it's a symbol of permanence. Will the sun always be there for you? No, it will not. It's not permanent. It's actually very erratic. It goes into, you know, red giant phase. It goes into stars, go through all sorts of modifications, and eventually they collapse. They explode, they're no more. They're not permanent. You don't get that feeling. You do not get that feeling. Whereas just a single flower in the real world, you realize that flower will never change or forsake you, ever. And that your awareness of that flower will never change or forsake it either. Permanent, stable. And that gives you this incredible, you know, depth of feeling and gratitude. It's different. You cannot get that feeling in this existence at all. Even if you worship the universe, even if the universe too is not permanent, the stars are not permanent, there's nothing in existence that you can get that feeling from. It's futile. So don't pursue being a scientist. Don't pursue being a nature worshiper. Don't pursue being a musician. Don't pursue being a relationship expert. Don't pursue any of that. Pursue satsang, inquiry, and listening to truth, and considering truth, and sorting out what is truth and what is a lie. Pursue that, and then someday you will literally accept the experience of the real world, and then you will have a feeling that is, you'll say, wow, this is exactly what I want. And everything else will absolutely fade into insignificance because, you see, this is real. This is permanent. This is real relationship. This is real delight. This is real experiencing. Everything else was just a fake. Ridiculous fake. How could I ever believe I could get what I want in impermanence? What a joke. What a joke. And so the real world will always be there. So we will all have that experience in common. That's the common experience we'll all have, is we will all eventually experience the real world. Just a matter of how long do we want to delay. So those who experience the real world come into this world and tell us, hey, they know we're all going to have this same experience. So they just say, come on, don't delay too much. Let's get into an inquiry. The real teachers say, inquiry, sort it out, work harder. Nanda Mahima, what was the best advice she would give? Work harder. That's it. It's the only advice she had. Work harder. Do more inquiry. I mean, for those who weren't into it, she might give them some other, you know, a pat on the back or a song, smile, reassurance. But those who are really serious who came to her, she'd just say, how much time are you spending per day on your spiritual inquiry? That's what she'd ask. And, you know, you'd say, well, 2 hours in the morning and two in the evening. She goes, could you do some, I want to ask a personal favor of you. Could you do a favor for me? And you'd say, sure, I'll do anything for it. She says, could you make it 3 hours in the morning and 3 hours in the evening? That's literally, you know, people think that Ananda Maimon was giving all sorts of like deep spiritual advice, you know, mystical stuff. No. She'd just say, you know, and she'd say, come back, you know, and I'll see you again. So she'd see him again in 3 years or whatever. And she'd say, how much time are you giving now in your contemplation and you're sorting it all out? And you say, well, you told me 3 and 3, so I'm doing 3 and 3. And she goes, well, make it 4 and 4, 4 in the morning, 4 in the evening, and try to expand it to even more. Continually try to expand it, right? Don't just sit on 4. Once you get to 4, make it 5. That's all she would say. And then she'd say, I'll see you again sometime. So the idea that there's some guru that is going to give you some secret initiation and give you some secret knowledge is a fantasy. I think Ananda Maimon is the greatest teacher, you know, as great a teacher as ever been on the planet. There could have been others that of equal greatness, because she was flawless, and she didn't have any mystical advice. She didn't have any initiation, or, you know, secret this or that. Well, I mean, I'm sure she could give out mantras or whatever about, you know, but her advice was simply, how much time are you giving to your effort? And her advice was always, give it more effort. That is the secret. That is the secret of the gurus. The secret of the siddhas. Siddhis, whatever. The secret of the avahuts. You know, you travel all the way to some mountaintop in Tibet. There you have some avahut, you know, who's at one with identity, reality. And you say, I've come all this way, and I know you've got the secret answer for me. And I'm a great devotee, and please tell me the secret. And they will say, you wasted all this time, 2 years, trying to come here to see me. You could have been sitting in your suburban home, giving 10 hours a day to inquire in satsang instead. What a fool. What a fool. And you say, what's your advice? I need your advice as well. Make it 12 hours a day in satsang in your little suburban house. Now, go and do it. That is the secret, the method of the cities, the secret of the cities, the more effort. Spend more quality time sorting it out. That's the secret. Because only that will work. That's all that will work. That's it. Nothing else works. The ego, our denial is too, you know, is so... We're so into our denial that it seems all so clever. And so it's baffling to us, you know. And sorting it through so that we don't keep expanding our denial, you know. Sorting it through so we less and less and less and less. It takes work. I think Ramana Maharshi said, look, you gotta work at it. Really got to work at it. Any teacher will tell you that you really have to work at it, as we're doing here. I'm spending in total this morning, on a Sunday morning, I've already spent setting everything up, getting into about at least, you know, 3 hours already, basically 3 hours already. And of course, the guru would say, well, you know, more. They're never going to say less. Never going to pat you on the back and say, that's enough, that's enough. No, never. Never. I say, have you finished? No? Well, give it more time then. Come on, work harder. Get it all sorted out. So you found out the secret of the gurus here. Now you know. Behind the closed doors, you go into their, you know, get past all their watchdogs and guards and all those people sorting out, you know, you can't see them yet, you know, you're not ready. You finally get past all that, and you finally come to the guru in the little, you get into the room, you think, wow, is this like going to be a spaceship in here? What's going on? And it's just a simple little chair, little seat. They're just sitting there. Say, come on in, come on in. And you come in and you think, okay, they're going to give me some personal advice that is going to change my life. You're all nervous. And they're just going to, you know, talk, chat a while with you. And after you calm down and relax, they'll say, okay, so, you know, what's your effort like? And then they'll talk about your effort, how much effort you're putting in. And they'll say, okay, you need to find a way to put in a little more effort. That's it. Pretty much it, you know. That's pretty much what you're going to hear, no matter where you go. That's the bottom line. So eventually they get to the bottom line. And the only people who get into the room to see the guru, you know, are those who are willing to hear this. Those who don't want to up their effort or just want something, a miracle from the guru. You know, they're out there. And they get the song and the dance and little talk and little explanation. And they get, you know, say, hey, you know, try to do it 15 minutes a day or something. Maybe they'll do that for a little while. Try to set up a little group that can help meet, you know, once a week or twice a week. Start out with once a week and then try, you know, twice a week and then try every evening. You know, always, and on to my mind, always try to increase the effort of everyone. You know, start out once a week, 10 minutes, and then start out once a week, half an hour, and then start out twice a week, half an hour, and then expand it to every day, half an hour, and then expand it to 1 hour on the weekends and half an hour on the weekdays, and expand it then to 2 hours on the weekends and 1 hour on the weekdays. It's like that. Always, always pushing just that. More effort. That's all she's doing, pushing more effort. And then assuring us that the goal is there to be experienced. So I came in contact with these great teachers because I put in the effort, plain and simple. And the result of coming into contact was more effort, more sustained effort. You know, sustaining the effort even through feeling like I knew it was just, you know, I can't sustain it. I've tried so hard and I still don't have the answer. And they said, don't give up, sustain it. Come on, keep going. Sometimes we will give like, you know, 18 hours a day for like 3 years or whatever. That's all we do. And we don't reach the answer. We feel like dropping the whole thing. That can happen. Then the Greek gurus, you know, will come to you. Like Ramana did to me, said, keep going, don't stop. You'll get it eventually. You're on the right track. You just need a little more work, you know, you haven't quite sorted it out yet. And so you sustain it. You may not give 18 hours every day because, you know, you feel like, wow, you know, I'm not sure if it's gonna work or not, but you need to keep sustaining it through thick and thin. And keep finding every day, find ways to make, you know, exceptional progress in some way. And I can say in my life, I feel like every day I've made exceptional progress. Very, very rarely has there been a day when that has not happened. Every day there's been some progress, most days exceptional progress. That is my feeling. So, you know, I wouldn't go to sleep until that is true. So if you feel like there's a day where you just got nowhere, you know, before you go to sleep, you know, it's very important to say, wait a minute, let me spend like a half an hour more really focusing in and see if I can get the feeling of exceptional progress. And it's tough to sustain this because the results don't arrive as quickly as we like, because the ultimate result we're looking for is experience in the real world. Until we get that, we don't have results. Until we get that, we have not gotten the results that we want. So we have to keep going. Keep the effort up. So that's why I'm talking blah blah blah, you know. It's good talk though. I look at the other videos that are available and I just say, wow, you know, I'm glad I'm doing these videos because I just don't see anybody out there that is talking directly about the real world, talking directly about the issues I've been talking about. I don't see it. So I'm saying, well, I'm good thing I'm doing this. because I think it's the right thing to do. I don't like to see a world where there is not this type of teaching going on. I don't like to see it. It's very depressing. Because even the best teachers, you know, I still say, you know, hey, you know, I think something more could be given. Now, in order to be recognized at all in this world, you kind of need to dumb it down. Otherwise, very few people are going to listen to you at all. So it may be that there's some really good teachers that are dumbing it down just for the sake of reaching people. And that, you know, if they have intensives where those are really keen on it, then they'll give the full scope, you know, what's being told. Maybe not. I'm not going to waste my time, you know, figuring it out. Look, because I'm not going to take time away from my own inquiry to chase after that. Because if I can produce these videos here, then I feel I'm doing what needs to be done. Where are we at now? We're at the 221. That's a good time to stop. 221. As we come up on 12:21:12, which is supposed to be both a belief in some great transformation, great change. Of course, as they always say, great transformation also means great loss, right, etc. So it's a time of a lot of hullabaloo in existence, a real mashup, a real lot of stuff happening. And it'd be very, very good if we're experiencing the real world at that time, close to that time. Very, very smart thing to do. Don't be stupid, be smart. Nothing wrong with being really, really smart. And again, even a caveman has the smarts to choose to experience the real world. Okay, very great. Let's wrap it up here. Let's wrap it up. Have a great day. And who knows, I may make another video. I don't know. I never plan ahead. I never plan the next one. I don't know what I'll do. I have no idea. I have no idea what I'll do in the rest of the day. But by having no set plan, I'm able to shift and do something really, you know, profound, because there's no plans that I need to break in order to do this. So I literally make no plans for any day. Don't have any plans. Just see what comes up. All right, very great. That's it for this video.